Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Math Homework Hotline. I'm Tammy Derry.
And I'm Hannah Hanna, everybody.
And we are glad you're watching our show tonight because our show is designed just for you to help you with your math homework. So go ahead and get those math questions ready, and our teachers are ready for them tonight. We've got teachers answering the phones right now, so go ahead and call in, and that number is going to come up along the bottom of your screen. It's 813-840-7260. So keep our teachers busy tonight with those math homework questions. If you happen to be away from your television and you're not able to watch us, don't forget that we are streaming live. So if you have to step away, go ahead and take your tablet with you if you have one, or a device that you can watch the internet on, and you can watch us live. That website, oh, they've already got it up for me. Thank you, guys. It's mhh.mysdhc.org. And you can take us with you to go. I've actually watched the show that way myself occasionally when I've needed to be away and someone else was filling in just to see what's happening around here when I'm gone. And talking about what's happening tonight, what's happening is a great topic, and it's all about this. Yeah. Tonight's topic is all about linear functions, and this is going to help lots of students at all levels, so make sure that you're watching, even if you're not our target audience, which typically is our middle school age students. This is definitely great for high school students as well, all the way up to college, actually. So linear functions, graphing, we're going to be writing and looking at some of those functions, applying and explaining what linear equations are. So go ahead and grab some paper if I were you and take some notes tonight, or make sure you watch it when we do the playbacks because it's going to be a great show. And don't forget that every time we do a live show, we actually have a challenge question for you, and it's tied right to that topic tonight. So I'm going to pass it over to Hannah to see what you have planned for us tonight with that great challenge question that you worked on.
Yes, Tammy, I have a good one that people would love doing it. Let's take a look, everybody. Yeah. It reads, for the function f of x equals 2x plus 15, find the value of f of f negative 1 of 20 all. Let me read it one more time. It says, for the function f of x equals 2x plus 15, find the value of f of, see, when I open a pair of parentheses here, I don't say quantity, I say of. F of. Inside the parentheses, there is f negative 1 of 20. Close that on the 20 for the f to the negative 1. And then close again for the bigger parentheses, or the first parentheses we open. So it reads f of f negative 1 of 20 all. All right, everybody. What is f negative 1? We're going to talk about it in just a few seconds. We're going to give you sample sample problems on how to get the f negative 1 of any function f. You're going to see that in a few seconds. Tammy, back to you.
All right. Thanks, Hannah. Before I get started, I want to just remind you that we are still taking the names to go into the drawing for the first Kindle that we'll give away this year. The way that your name goes in for that Kindle drawing is you need to call in and speak to one of our teachers who are answering the phones with a real math question. They'll take your name and your school, and you'll go into that drawing. We will be drawing the Kindle soon over the next couple of weeks, so make sure you call in tonight if you're interested in being in the drawing for that. And don't forget, we do come out to your school. I'm so excited. I love this part. We come out to your school, and we actually bring it to you, so I get to meet you, and it's really, really a lot of fun. Love doing that. And if you are calling in tonight, you might be a random winner of one of our Do the Math t-shirts. There it is. It says Do the Math on that side. And on the back, it has our Math Homework Hotline logo that you see on the television. And we will randomly choose those. So our teachers that are accepting the calls in the back will select names randomly, and we'll give those out. They go to your math teacher. So make sure you ask if you happen to win tonight. So keep watching for that. Talking about watching, let's take a look at some math. Let's see what we have here. We're going to talk about linear functions tonight. So on my board, I've written out the word linear function and just a quick information about it. So you'll see like a mini definition. I've pulled a couple of resources and looked, because basically what I want you to have in your mind when you look at the definition on my board is that a function is one that it forms a line when graphed. So it's going to a function that forms a straight line when graphed. That's what you should kind of have in your mind. Now, you could probably pull lots of math resources and pull lots of things, and you'll hear or read different interpretations of a linear function, but the key thing that will always stick out is that it will form a straight line when graphed. That's kind of the key thing to remember. So sometimes we get all tied up in the math words, but really just focus on that. So what I've done is I picked a very easy equation, a linear equation, which we're going to talk about much deeper as we go into the show, but just for you to get an idea of what you would see. So in a linear function, in this case, we have a y equals 2x. Now let's relate that to the graph. This is the x-axis, and the vertical axis is the y-axis. So we have points that would be plotted, and when we're done, because it's a linear function, it should form a line. So I have my ruler handy tonight because we want math people tend to like to draw straight lines. I don't know why, but we do. So when we'll grab my ruler in a moment. So it says y equals 2x. So I've chosen some values for x, and what I'm going to do is I will put them into the equation, and I will get a y value. So then I will take each one, and I will plot the x and the y values. So here's what I've done. I've selected 0. So if I take the equation for y equals 2x, I would say 2 times the 0 equals 0. So the y value is 2 times 0 equals 0. So all I did was plug in the value for 0 where the x is to see what I get, which is the 0. Let me do it again. I'm going to do 2 times, this time I'm going to put in 1 in that position. So 2 times 1, so that's where the 1 went, equals 2 times 1, which is 2. So now I have that, and then I'll do the same thing with the 2. So 2, the parenthesis means times, just like 2 times x. I'll take the 2 and put it in for the x, and I'm going to get 4. So what I've got here now is I've created some coordinates that I'm going to graph. I'm going to use my smaller black pen just to show you kind of what I ended up with. So I have an x and a y coordinate. So this one's going to be 0, 0. This one is going to be 1, 2. And this one is going to be 2, 4. So that's where those coordinates come from. They have an x and a y value. Then I go to my graph, which is over here, and I'm going to plot the points. So let me do that very quickly. So 0, 0 is the origin. You'll hear us talk about that throughout the show, because that point is where the x and the y-axis meet. That's where the axes originate. So 0, 0 means that when I'm on the graph, I don't go to the right or to the left, and I don't go up or I don't go down. I stay right at 0, 0. For this one, I'm going to go on the x, 1, and I'm going to go on the y, 2. So there's a game out there. It's called Battleship. If you've ever played it, it really is helpful when you to learn how to graph, because it's kind of the same idea. So you're going to go over 2. That's your x. And you're going to go up to the 4. So hopefully I can put that in there in a nice good spot for me to draw my line with my ruler. And I'm going to go ahead and connect those. And if we have time, we might even get a chance to talk, Hannah, about continuous and discrete data. Mm-hmm. If we have time. I don't know if we'll get that far, but those of you watching, if you know what it is, you're like, oh yeah, I remember that. Well, what I've done now is I've created a linear function from the equation. It's a linear function because it forms a straight line, and it will continue on to infinity as many as I want to put in there. It actually would continue into the other quadrant, which is the third quadrant as well. I just only did the first quadrant when I drew my graph, just to give us an example. But we'll do many, many more, guys and girls that are watching, that will involve all the quadrants. So big, exciting times. And speaking of exciting times, guess what I saw in the corner of my eye?
What is it?
I'm going to spoil it for you. We have a challenge question winner.
Yes, we do. And the challenge question winner is none other than Sam. And Sam goes to Williams. Hello, Sam. How are you?
Good.
Well, welcome to Math Homework Hotline, Sam. We're very proud of you. We're honored to have you here with us on the line with Math Homework Hotline. Sam, I have not received you as a winner before, but I'm sure you've been a winner all your life. But welcome to the winning club. You're very, very... You made it to that club, and you are now a very elite member of it. We're very proud of you. Tell us, Sam, what is it your final answer?
20.
And 20 is the right answer, Sam, and that makes you the challenge question winner for tonight. Yes, you are. See, everyone is applauding for Sam, and I am too. Here we go. Sam, tell us, how do you walk through this? How do you...
Well, I walk... Because I... fx plus 2x, 15. So
okay.
I got x and 2x. And I got equals 30. And it's 30 parentheses, negative 1, in parentheses again, 20, in the parentheses, n. So... 31
equals
30th, and I got
range of 20. I'm not very sure if you did it the right way, Sam, to be honest with you. It wouldn't forbid you of being the winner. Don't misunderstand me. But did you work what we call the inverse function? Did you work the f negative 1 of 20?
No.
No. Then I'm sorry to tell you, you did not do it the right way. But you know what? You called for a reason. You are the winner. We're not going to take this away from you. Okay? You're a winner no matter what. But let me tell you, it's time for you to learn how to find the f negative 1. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Here's what we do. When f of x equals 2x plus 15, that means if I entered any value of x, I take it, times it by 2, and then add 15 to it. That's what that function f does. So if I entered 10, f of 10 then as a function, f of 10 would be 2 times 10 is 20. Plus 15 is 35. So f of 10 equals 2 times 10 plus 15. That is 20 plus 15, which is 35. Now, what does f negative 1 do? F negative 1 is supposed to be the function that if we took 35, it would take it back to 10 as a result. Like exactly, I always use this analogy. You went to one of the department stores or one of the, like Target or Walmart stores, and you purchased something. You paid X dollars for it. You went home, you didn't like it, broke or some, and or you did not like what you expected to see, so you took it back. You took it back with a receipt, and you refunded your money back. This is what the inverse function does, like refunding the product. I don't mean product like timesing, but I mean the product like whatever you purchased. So say here we have f of 10. F of 10 is 35. You don't like it, take it back to the store. You should take it back to the store. That is the inversing thing. The inversing thing is to take it back to the store and you get your money back, which is the 10. See? F of 10 is 35. The 10 bought you the 35. You don't want it. You don't like it. Take the 35 back with the receipt. You get your money back. This is what we call the inverse function. Your job and my job together now is to find that f negative 1 for this particular f. Every function, not every function, I should not say every, because some do and some don't. Some functions have their inverses, and some functions don't have their inverses. If the function happened to be one of those that have inverses, then its inverse is called f negative 1. If the function itself is f, then its inverse is called f negative 1. If the function itself is g, then its inverse is called g negative 1. And we put that negative 1 as if it is an exponent, but it's not really an exponent. We just say f negative 1. That's the name of it. And it should take the resulting element back, put it in, and it takes it back to the original that you have entered to start with. So the main job right now, Sam, is to find that f negative 1 for this particular f of x. There are some processes to do. Step 1 is to take that f of x and say, you are y, are you not? F of x would say proudly, yes, I am. Because always x is the element that goes into the machine that we call function, and then y is the image. So that f of x is the image, which is y, equals 2x plus 15. Everybody watching with Sam, please, 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 pay close attention, because if you haven't studied inverse functions yet, you will soon. If you haven't studied functions yet, you will soon. So please, please, pay your best attention. Here, your first step is to call it y, and you rewrite the same function. Step two is to swap every x with y and every y with x. Can you do that, Sam? Go ahead. Tell me what should I write now? You have a y here. You put x.
Can you repeat the question, please?
All right. We are in the process of finding the f negative 1, and that is step one of it is to name it y. Name the original function y, and we did that. Step two is to switch or to swap every x. You put y instead of it, and every y you put x instead of it. You get it? So when I have y here, I put it what? Come on, Sam. When I see y here, I put what instead? X. And when I have x here, I put y. Plus 15 remains plus 15. Then we do something called solve for this y. Solving for y means finding y alone on one side. So how would I isolate y alone on one side? I have to get rid of the 15 and then get rid of the 2. How would I get rid of the 15? I have to subtract 15 from both sides. And this would make 2y, this would cancel out, equals x minus 15. And then I divide by 2 here, divide by 2 here, and divide by 2 here. 2 divided by 2 is y, equals x divided by 2 means half x, minus 15 divided by 2 is 7.5. So here we go. This is what we call the inverse function. Take it back again to the function language. So instead of y, we say f negative 1 of x equals half x minus 7.5. And I'm going to take the opportunity, everybody, for those of you that did not learn inverse functions before, to have the fun of it with me right now as we play back and forth. We buy a product. We go home, we don't like it, take it back, get our money back. Here we go. If I inserted 10 here, I got 35, right? In the original function, f of 10 is 35. Now, this is the inverse function. If I put the 35 here for x, guess what? I promise you, we're going to get 10 out of this operation here. Let's go. F negative 1 of 35... F negative 1 of 35. Let's try that. That is half 35. Half 35, everybody, is 17.5. Minus 7.5. 17.5, everyone, minus 7.5 is none other than 10. And guess what? This is the same 10 that we have paid first to get that product. So if I pay 10, I get 35. If I took 35 back, I get my 10 back. See? So now let's get, after we developed this f negative 1 of x, we got this. If I get f negative 1 of 20 now, then get f of that 20. Then I would tell you some secret solution for that. Let me change color so we can just know exactly where we are regarding the board. It's very limited. Okay, here's red. So what is the process then? You want to get this part first and then get its function, its image, but with the f itself. So f negative 1 of 20. First of all, I would have to enter 20 here instead of x. So f negative 1 of 20 would equal half 20, that is 10, minus 7.5. That is 2.5. That's f negative 1 of 20. What about f of that? So f of 2.5, and I hope Sam is following up with me. I know it's a tiny bit higher than sixth grade level, but I know you can catch up with me. F of 2.5 is, you take 2.5 and insert it here for x. So that is 2 times 2.5, everybody, which is 5 plus 15. And all of a sudden, you get the 20 that we have inserted here for the f negative 1. So the answer, the final answer, that is the f of this, and this ended being 2.5. The function of this 2.5, everybody, is back to the 20. Okay, now, Hannah, what is it, the secret you wanted to tell us? The secret is this, everybody. As these are inverse of each other, they undo each other. Means f of negative 1 of anything here, it will give you the same result. If this is 100, it will give you back 100. If this is 200, it will give you back 200. If this is 2.3, it will give you back 2.3. If this is 17, it will give you back to 17. When whatever element you put here, as long as you have f here and f negative 1, they undo each other and give you the exact value that you have entered here as x will be the final answer for that. That's why if you ask me, and I want you to learn that, Sam and everybody, if you ask me, without doing this whole amount of work, once you see f of f negative 1 of something, take that something, put it as a result, and announce your answer right away. You don't need to take any more seconds to do any of this kind of work. All right? I just did it so that we can show our grade 6 students like Sam and others that are watching how to do it. Also 7th graders and 8th graders as well. Those have not done yet enough work on functions and inverse functions. Now you know the secrets of functions and inverse functions. I hope you enjoyed that. And if you do enjoy it, now you tell your friends how good it is and keep them watching. And by the way, Sam, we do have 2 reruns or 2 replays during the week. If you want to watch it again, watch it on Monday or Wednesday of this coming week. All right? Have a good night, Sam, and thank you for being our winner for tonight.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, my dear. Bye. Tammy, back to you.
All right. Thanks, Hannah. And actually, that's a very interesting thing for students to learn because that is a lot of work. That is a big problem to do. But once you realize that the function and the inverse function give you that answer,
right,
it does make things much easier. So thank you, Hannah, for sharing that.
Thank you.
All right. We're going to go ahead and take a look a little bit more on tonight's topic related to functions. And on my board, I have what we call slope-intercept form. So I'm starting here. We're going to go much deeper. I'm just trying to get some basics down at the beginning here so that when we get into more involved problems, you'll have the language that we need. So it says y equals mx plus b. So let's start on this side. So earlier I did a problem where you saw y, you saw a number 2, an x, and then there was nothing else. So I want to announce to you now so that you know that the number that sits in front of the x is the slope. Now, it's represented by the letter M, and I know Hannah and I have had lots of conversations about why did they use the letter M, and I think we've even both done a little research, something about mountains, and he might expand on that later, and so forth, but the letter M is representing the slope, so we'll start there, and the letter B is representing the y-intercept. So when you have these two things in place, and the equation is written just like this, if you see it with number values, like over here where it says y equals 2x plus 3, then you already can identify the slope, and we'll talk about that in a moment, is 2, and the y-intercept is this value 3. Now, what does a y-intercept mean? Well, we are in the fall of the year, if you're watching us right now live, and it's football season. So the way I always try to help you remember is if you ever watch a football game and they say, oh, there was an interception, that means that the other team grabbed the ball midpoint, they're throwing the ball, and it was supposed to, let's say I was supposed to throw the ball to Hannah, and somebody runs across in front of us and grabs the ball. They intercepted it, they took it. So what a y-intercept is in mathematics when we're looking at a graph is where does the line cross the y-axis? Where does it stop? Where's that interception at? So let's take a look. Well, first of all, before we even get to that, remember when I did the previous problem, if you've been watching, I made a table and I made an XY table and we picked values and we had to go through the process of inserting the values. Well, if you know that you have a slope-intercept form, you don't need to do a table of values. We can actually even take my magic eraser here by the magic of television and make it go away. We don't need that. Because once I know that I have it in slope-intercept form, I'm ready to go to a graph. I know that this is the x and this is the y. So the first thing I know is that the y-intercept is at the value of positive 3. So on the y-axis, I start at the origin. That's where we always start counting. And we go up 3 spaces. 1, 2, 3. So right there, that point, and I'm actually, let me see if I can grab my red pen because I would like for it to show up a little bit better if you're where you're watching at home. So hopefully you can see that. And again, also, I always emphasize the size of my dots when I'm working on television because I want to make sure you see it. You don't necessarily have to make them that large when you're doing homework or work in your classroom. So we've handled this part of it, but now we want to talk about the slope. The slope is represented by the change that you're looking at in terms of the way the line goes. So is it steep or is it flat? All of those types of things. So I'm going to start off with just talking about it in terms of the rise over the run. And you'll notice that there's no fraction there. But whenever you're dealing with slope, you have to, in your mind, in your little thought bubble, think of this really as 2 over 1. Because every slope, it went off the top. Let me thought bubble on the other side. Hannah didn't catch me there. So let me thought bubble over here. It's 2 over 1. So you always have a rise and a run, even if it's not identified. So just as a quick way to graph, you would go to your y-intercept position. You would rise 2 spaces from the 3. And I know that I would go up because it's a positive 2, 1, 2. And then I would run, meaning I would go across 1 space to the right because it's positive. So if it's positive, you go up. If it's positive, you go right. If those numbers would have had any negatives, I would have followed that direction. Now somewhere I've lost my ruler. There it is. And you could continue on making points and they would follow a straight line. So let me just go from here and go one more time. I could go up 2 and over 1. Now you will see Hannah and I lots of times when we're graphing, if we run out of room, we'll reverse the process. Because this is a positive slope, if I go down 2 and left 1, a negative over a negative creates a, I know you're all saying it in your head,
positive.
A positive. Mm-hmm. So let me quickly pull in my line because we're going to go much deeper than this in just a moment. I know Hannah's getting ready to. But now you would see that I could quickly sketch that graph. So I didn't need to make the table. I didn't need to figure out all the calculations. If it's in slope-intercept form, that's like one of those happy moments in math, mm-hmm. Hannah. You know how like when you're working in mathematics and all of a sudden you'd say, it's in slope-intercept form, you go, yay, I love it.
Yep.
It's just like a touchdown.
You're
like
very
football.
Right. Kids love hearing that y equals mx plus b.
I know, because you know what to do. It's good stuff.
Exactly.
You know what else is good stuff?
Yes.
Okay, good stuff is when I get to give away t-shirts.
I love
that
moment.
So let me find my t-shirt because I don't want you to forget what I'm giving away here. I'm giving away these Math Homework Hotline t-shirts. They're very, very nice. I have one. Hannah has one. Wear them all the time. Very exciting.
I love
going out to schools and seeing the kids in their Math Homework Hotline t-shirts. So let's see who's going to be wearing some soon. From Sly, the first one is going to Amina. Love that. Amina. Love that name. Great. All right, another
great... Wait until you see the third knee.
I know, I love it. All right, so I took a peek, Hannah. It's okay. Calm down. Hannah's getting excited. You'll know why in a minute. Okay, from Barrington, we have another winner, another beautiful name, Adriana. Very nice. Congratulations to our students out at Barrington. We love that opportunity to get out there anytime I can. Great, great opportunity to visit classrooms for math out there. All right, and now Hannah from Rampello. Yes, yes, yes. A Do the Math shirt is going to somebody named Hannah at Rampello.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
Hello, Hannah. Congratulations to all of you.
He's so excited. They even put you up on the screen. Look.
Congratulations, everybody. Wear those shirts proudly, all right? And brag about it. All right.
Hannah, you're too much. You get too excited because somebody has your name.
I do.
You even got a cameo spot during my time to give away t-shirts. All right, Hannah, back to you for some math. Let's do it.
And you know what, Tammy? I'm going to build on what you just covered.
Great.
I'm going to do the other way around. For example, you gave us the equation, and then you, based on the equation, you got to your slope, your y-intercept, and then you graphed it. I'm going to play it backward. Let's take a look, everybody. I have the graph ready for you. And now my question is, go find your slope, find your y-intercept, find the equation. So Tammy played it from left to right. I'm playing it from right to left. Same topic, though. It's the y equals mx plus b thing, but we do not have anything. It's very blank here, okay? We want you to do the job. We want you to find your slope, find your y-intercept, find your equation, put them together and find your equation, and then give us a call. I'm just kidding. All right, here is the line. We look at the line and say, how can I communicate with you? Who are you? The line said, well, I am a line, goes through some good points that you can use. So I tried to track those good points that the line is talking about. And when the line talks good points, or any graph thing talks good points, they mean actually the points that have very integral or integer kind of like coordinates. Points that are in corners of these squares, basically. Like this point is not one of the very good ones, because we'd have to do a lot of rounding and estimating and stuff. But this one here is a good one. So let's circle it. Here's a good one there. Look at those. Look at those beautiful points here. And those are the points that the graph is talking about. I have some good points. And it is very true. These are good points. Let's try to find out their coordinates. This point here is 0 and 1. So put here 0 and 1. Sorry about this noise here. This one here is 1 and 1, 2, 3, 4. Order pair 1 and 4. Who are you? This point says, well, if you go to the origin, turn left, then go south 2 blocks, you find me. So this is very true. Left 1 block, that is negative 1. South 2, that's negative 2. Here is this order pair. What about this one? This one is negative 1, negative 2, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, negative 4, negative 5. So it's negative 2 and negative 5. We already identified the four good points that the graph was talking about. Of course, there are infinite number of good points, but we don't have room for all of them, and we don't have time for all of them. Listen. How can I then use these to find what Tammy has explained to us? Slope. Remember the slope Tammy said? It's rise over run. True. This is exactly what we call M, lowercase m for slope. So moving from one point, here I am, to this point, how many would I rise and how many would I have to run to go from this point to this point? Let's go. Are you ready to come with me? Let's go. Rise once, twice, 3 units, then run once. So it's basically rise 3 and run 1. That means rise 3 and run 1 means that the slope is actually 3 ratio 1. And that can be simplified as 3, but you understand it's rise over run. So here's my slope, my M equals 3. Let's now work together, everybody, to find the y-intercept. As Tammy explained, the y-intercept is where the y will intersect with the x-axis. The y-axis will intersect with the line, or the line will intersect with the y-axis. And they do intersect here at this point. This part here, let me do it in different color. This part here, everybody, is what we call the y-intercept. What is it? It's one whole. Positive 1? Yes, positive 1. So this is what we call lowercase b. It's positive 1. We got our treasures. M is 3. B is 1. Now I can form my equation. And my equation is always y equals mx plus b. See that music? You hear that music? Y equals mx plus b. Everyone in algebra 1, pre-algebra, knows and should know the y equals mx plus b song. Now, keep the y as is, keep the x as is, keep the equal as is. Plug in what you have or substitute what you have for m, it's 3. Put 3. Plus, plug in or substitute for what you have for b, it's 1. And guess what? I am done. We have the slope, we have the y-intercept, and we have the equation. You cannot beat that. Look how fun it is to watch math homework online. and wait until you see what Tammy has for us. It's all yours.
Well, thank you, Hannah. Actually, I have an opportunity to help one of our students, so let me see if I can get our caller on the line. Hi there.
Hi.
How are you, Jaden?
Good. How are you?
Good. I'm glad that you called in tonight. It looks like you have a good problem for us to work on.
Yes.
I'm going to read it to you to make sure I have it correctly. Are you watching on your television?
I actually do not have cable.
Okay, so you don't have it on. Okay, then I'm going to make sure that I talk through the steps really well with you. They will be putting it up on the television, so other people will be able to see it. So you'll be able to help others as well. So on the equation that you called in with, it says negative 6F plus 13 equals 2F minus 11. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So when you're looking at this, one of the first steps you want to do, Jaden, is put all of the variables on one side. Do you know what a variable is?
Yes, like A, Z.
Yeah, perfect. Any letter. So in this case, the variable in this equation is what letter?
It is F.
F. So we want to put all of the Fs to one side of the equation. It doesn't matter which side you move to. A lot of people like to put them on the left, and some people even move them to the right. It's up to you. So I'm going to let you pick. Do you want me to put all the Fs on the left side of the equation, on the left side of the equal sign, or to the right?
Let's do to the right.
To the right. Do you have any idea why you might want to do that?
Because I think differently, and it's easier for me to do it on the right.
Okay. So in order for me to do that, I'm going to add 6F to both sides. So 6F is going to be added to the left, and I'm going to add 6F to the right. So you can't see what I'm doing right now, but what I've done is underneath where it said negative 6F, I put plus 6F.
Okay.
And 6F minus 6F, if I say that in my head, what do I end up with?
You end up with 12.
If I have a minus and a plus, do I get anything left?
No.
No. So those are going to go away. So on the left side, the only thing I have left now is that 13.
Okay.
Okay. So that's going to be set equal to, we were adding 6F to the 2F on the right-hand side. So what is 6F plus 2F?
8.
So I have 8F, and then I still have that minus 11, so I'm going to bring that down too. So, Jaden, I want to make sure we're at exactly the same point. So right now, I should have, and you should have, 13 equals 8F minus 11. Do you have that?
Yes.
Perfect. Now, our whole goal is to get the F by itself, and in this case, we're going to put it on the right-hand side. So that minus 11 on the right, I need to move that and basically eliminate it on the right and add it on the left side. So whatever I do to one side, I do to the other. So instead of minus 11, I'm going to add 11 to both sides.
Okay.
And now tell me what you end up with on the left.
22.
You're very close. Check again. 13 plus 11.
24.
Good job. So 24 is equal to, now that minus 11 and that plus 11 went away. So the only thing left on the right-hand side now is what?
That would be 13 equals 8F.
It would be the 24.
Yes.
Equals 8F. Are we together?
Okay. Yes.
Okay, so on the line where we both are, it says 24 equals 8F. Now, I want to ask you a question. I don't know if you've done this yet or not. They didn't tell me what grade you're in. So when you have an 8 times an F side by side like that, do you know what the inverse or the opposite operation of multiplication is?
That would be, I haven't quite learned that yet.
Okay. Well, let me kind of talk you through it. So you have 8 and an F sitting side by side. When any time a number and a letter are side by side with no dot or no sign or symbol between them, it means they're multiplied.
Okay.
And the inverse of multiplication is division, so they undo each other. So if I have 8 times F on the right, I'm going to have to divide both sides by 8, because whatever I do to one side, I have to do the other. So I'm dividing 8F by 8, and then I'm going to divide the 24 by 8.
Okay.
All right, so now that 8 and that 8 on the side by the F, well, they'll cancel out because it becomes 1 divided by 1, which is 1. So then we will be left with 24 divided by 8. Do you know how many times 8 goes into 24?
That would be, hang on one second. Maybe 5?
It's a little high. I think it's a little lower than that. So if you thought about your times tables for your 8s, it would be 8, 16, and then 24. So it would be 8 times 3
okay.
would equal 24. So the answer would actually end up being 3. Where you went to, 8 times 5 would have been 40. It would have been a little bit too high. So the answer to that question would have been that F is equal to 3. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Thanks for calling in. Have a great day tomorrow.
You too.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Tammy, we're going to take a look at civil graphs and decide which ones identify with what we call linear functions and which do not. All right? Let's take a look, everybody, and see the fun board that we have here. Very colorful. I tried to make it as colorful as I can make it. Look at this one here. I know the whole big chart has the big x-axis and the big y-axis, but please ignore those and just look at every one of these graphs separately. We're going to start with this one as graph number one. This is graph number two. We're going to go then to graph 3, and then we're going to go to graph 4, which I have not illustrated yet. All right, here's graph number 1, everybody. Pair the definition that Tammy introduced to us in the very beginning. First thing Tammy did today was to introduce to us what is really meant by the word linear function. It is basically, per her research and per references that she went to, she defined it as a function that when you graph it, it yields a straight line. And is this yielding a straight line? Of course it is. So this would be a linear function. And once you approve that it is a linear function, then let's find out its slope, quick, y-intercept, quick, equation, quick. Let's go, everybody. Slope, identify 2 points. Here's a good one. I mean, 2 good points, okay? Those are at corners. Here's one, here's two. I can use these two to do what I need to do. Slope, going from here to here. How many units would I have to rise? Well, unfortunately, Hannah, you're going to go down. Down means negative. So here's down 1, that's negative 1, over 2. Means slope here, everybody, is negative 1 over 2. That's negative half. Okay, Hannah, we got that. What about the y-intercept? How much of this y-axis does this intercept here? It's this part, and that is negative 1. So b, lowercase b, is basically negative 1. You have m, you have b. Now we can find the slope, sorry, the equation. The equation is basically y equals, remember, mx plus b. Let's substitute. That would be y equals, let's go. M is negative 1 half, x plus b is what? Negative 1. So here's the equation of the line, everybody. And that is what we call linear function. And another feature, I can tell you this secret, and I'm sure Tammy would approve this. Another feature that you can look at the equation itself and decide whether it is linear or not, is first it would have x and y, only, not x squared, not y cubed, nothing, x power 1, y power 1, or at least one of the two with power 1 still. There is no power 2, no power 3, and no xy term. See, x power 1, y power 1, no x squared, no y cubed, no x cubed, no y squared, nothing. Okay, and no term of xy. That makes it very linear one. What about this one? Does this yield a straight line? I see you laughing and I hear you laughing. Okay, I got it. It's not. It does not really present a line. So it doesn't yield a straight line, means it is not a linear function. So this is out of the picture for now. What does this look like? It's called parabola. And when we take later on what we call second degree functions or quadratic functions, that would be what we call a parabola. And that's what this graph is about. All right. The third one here is, let me get the blue marker to draw another graph here. And this graph here is like this. Watch. Would this yield a straight line? No, of course not. So goodbye. It's out of our discussion for today. We may call this a third degree function later on, but for now, we have no business with it. Okay? Now, for this one here, let me now get the purple. If you get the pattern, green, I did red. Red, I did green. Here's purple, I did blue. So for blue, I have to keep consistency. Blue, I have to use the purple here. And here I can just plainly do this. Watch, everybody. This. And this. Oh, Hannah, this is the letter V. This is not a straight line. I say, well, what do you think it is? It's not a straight line. It's not a linear function. This is a kind of function that we call an absolute value function. When you study absolute value functions later on, you will find the graph of the absolute value functions is like this, exactly. But anyways, it is not linear. It's a combination of a line here or array here with another line here or array here. But it is by itself is not counted as a straight line or linear function. So it's out of the picture also. So the only one out of these four that qualifies for our lesson today is this one, and we successfully got its slope, y-intercept equation done. All right, everybody? We're going to throw it back to Tammy, see what she has to say.
All right. Thanks, Anna. Well, what I wanted to make sure we did before the end of the show, because we've talked a whole lot about slope-intercept form, and we haven't talked about what happens if it's not in slope-intercept form. Mm-hmm. So I want to show you quickly an equation that I've written on the board. And remember just a moment ago, Hannah did it, so I'm sure if you're watching, that you'll remember that slope-intercept form is y equals mx plus b. So this is kind of, I love my little thought bubble. So that's what I'm trying to get to. That's in my brain. And I look over here and it's not there. So I'm not going to be able to just graph it like Hannah just did. It's not going to happen. But what I can do is I can start taking this equation and making it look like slope-intercept form. There's different forms that are used when you're dealing with linear functions, and slope-intercept form is one of them. Standard form is another, and this one is not in standard form because the value in front of the x would need to be a integer. But when you look at this one, what I want to do now is simply just get this to slope-intercept form. So when I do this one, I look here and I see that I've got a 3y, but I've got this plus 1/2 x over here. So it's positive, and I want to move this part over because I want to get closer to having the x on the side with the number. Remember, the b is representing the y-intercept, so I'm going to go ahead and subtract. It's very simple when you look at it from this direction, because whatever you do to one side, you're doing to the other. And even though I'm writing really large on purpose, watch what happens. So if I have anything minus itself, I get 0. So those are gone. So that's already done. So now I'm left with 3y equals. And now here's the only reason I wrote this really big, because this is like I have a little puzzle here. I have a negative 1/2 x and I have a positive 18. But if I want to get to slope-intercept form, I want to move this. So instead of trying to write it underneath there, I'm going to say, okay, let me move this puzzle piece here and let me move the 18 here. The only thing I caution you on is whatever symbol or whatever sign, if it's a signed number, is in front of that number, it comes with it. You can't drop part of the puzzle piece off. You got to bring everything together. So this minus 1/2 x comes as a whole unit right here, and that's a plus 18. So now we're looking at what I have written in red. And when I look at this, I think, oh, I'm almost there. I saw that. I've seen something that looks like that. But here's the thing you have to remember, very important. The value of this coefficient, which we haven't used that word yet on the show, which is the number in front of the variable, has to be 1 in slope-intercept form. So I cannot have a 3 here. So I have to divide everything out by 3. So I would divide every part of this by 3. So when I would do this, I would get y equals, and then we'll talk about this part in a minute, and then plus 18 divided by 3 is 6. So remember that when we work with our complex fractions, we can pull this out. We could also, this is a time when you might want to use a calculator. So Hannah, we could use a calculator if we wanted to as I wrap this up. Oh, we're doing t-shirts. I was thinking that you were ready to do a problem.
No.
I'm so excited. So you could take a look at it that way as well. The decimal is not going to help you if you have to go to a graphing situation, though. Remember, you need a rise over a run. You could go ahead and work out the actual complex fraction if you wanted to, but you could keep it as rise over run as well.
Or we can do it long division too. I mean, not the long division. I mean, dividing what negative 1/2 by 3,
yep,
which is going to be negative 1 right. over 6.
So it would be negative 1 over 6 right. if you want to go ahead and work it out.
Right.
So I'm getting the cue, though, because they've already taken my board away, that I must move on to the T-shirts so they are not listening to me talk about this problem, I can tell. So, hello, crew. I'm on to T-shirts. Happy. All right. And I'm very happy because look at this. I got some new schools to talk about. All right. From Smith Middle School, we got a T-shirt going out to Jacob. Congratulations to Jacob from Smith Middle School. And another school that's a new name tonight. I'm so excited. Farnell Middle School. Congratulations to Colin. Yay. Good stuff.
Good job, right. guys.
All right. So there's our T-shirts for tonight. And Hannah, you've got something else you're going to share with us, right?
Sure.
All right.
I'm going to build on this example.
Okay. Let's do
and
it.
I'm gonna, before you erase it, let me just take it here.
Okay.
1 second. Here is the 1/2 x plus 3y, because I like the way you put it here.
Equals 18.
Thank you so mm-hmm. much. You see, everybody, when Tammy finished this, we kind of like followed up with her as she put it as y equals negative 1 over 6 plus x plus 6. Negative 1 over 6, x plus 6. Where did she get that negative 1 over 6? Do you remember? She had negative 1/2 divided by 3. When you divide that, this is 3 over 1. So that's basically negative 1/2 times 1/3. When you divide by 3 over 1, you multiply by the reciprocal, which is 1 over 3. Let's do it. Negative 1 times 1 is negative 1. 2 times 3 is 6. No wonder the slope here is negative 1 over 6. Now, with this being y equal this, I'm going to show you another way. So Tammy explained one way. I'm going to explain to you the other way, which can take us to this same result here. Watch. As Tammy explained, this is called the standard form. The standard form. When it is given to you as x's, y's equal constants, x's, y's equal constants, x's, y's equal constants, yes. I want you to keep that music in mind, and whenever you see it in that format, x is y is equal constant, that means that is in the standard form. Now, this coefficient of x we call uppercase A, and then we put x, plus this coefficient of y we call uppercase B, y, then this constant here we call it uppercase C. And yes, you have to stick with uppercase, lowercase, uppercase, lowercase, uppercase. We cannot play with those, okay? All right. How do you look at the standard form equation, or the equation in the standard form, and extract out of it the slope? You know, we know how we look at the y equals mx plus b form and extract the slope. It's the coefficient of x. It's negative 1 over 6. Done. We can look at this and find the y-intercept, it's 6, done. How would we then do the same kind of findings, except for straight from the standard form? Here's the rule. Slope, which is m, after you identify your uppercase A, uppercase B, uppercase C, slope, everybody, is negative the uppercase A over the uppercase B. Hannah, I don't believe you. I know you don't. But you're going to believe me now. Watch. It's equal to negative. The uppercase A, everybody, is 1/2 divided. Uppercase B is 3. And isn't this what we just did a while ago that ended with negative 1 over 6? See? Now you believe me. I know you do. Here's M. Slope is negative 1 over 6. Hannah, okay, what about the y-intercept? Is there a way to deal with the standard form, straightforward, to find the y-intercept? Of course. Math people are always known to be the problem solvers, and they always find solution for everything. So they figured out that the y-intercept, which is b, also equals the uppercase C over the uppercase b. Straightforward from the standard form. No need to go through the y equals mx plus b in order for you to get those two pieces. Let's go, everybody. What is C? C is 18. What's uppercase B? It's 3. And what's 18 divided by 3? It's 6. Uh-oh. Let's do this. Compare slope to slope. Compare y-intercept to y-intercept. You find them the same. So one way Tammy explained, and that's to take it from here, convert it into the y equals mx plus b, and that's very highly recommended. But if you want it to go straightforward from the standard form without going through the y equals mx plus b, you can. You can. And that is how. You find your a, b, and c, upper cases, and then m, remember this piece. This has to be memorized. m equals negative a over b, and b, lowercase b, equals uppercase c over uppercase b. Now, what is a? It's the coefficient of x, b is the coefficient of y, and c is the constant on the other side. And that is only applied when they give it to you as x's, y's equal constants. Have a great, you know, fun with it. All right, Tammy, back to you.
Well, thanks, Anna. It is
don't you like
fun.
This, too?
I do
Two
love
Two different
that.
Ways to approach the same mm-hmm. solution.
Yeah, it's definitely great to have lots of ways to approach a math problem. Mm-hmm. Well, so speaking of ways to approach a math problem, you don't know this, but when I came in tonight, Hannah gave me two equations. He said, before the end of the night, make sure that you graph these two equations. And I'm like, okay, why? So let's see what he wants me to figure out. So here we go. The red equation, my red arrow, says y equals 2x plus 1. Okay, Hannah, well, I already know from watching the show that it's in slope-intercept form, so I'm just going to go ahead and graph. Okay, so here I go. The y-intercept is at positive 1, so Hannah, just keep an eye on me here. And
sure.
The slope is 2, which we know is 2 over 1, so we've kind of graphed something like this. So from the y-intercept, I'm going to rise 2 and move over 1, all right? And then I'll go up 2 and over 1 one more time. So, Hannah, is this what you wanted me to do with this one?
Sure.
Okay, well, they
you
look
are in the right track.
They look kind of alike, so I don't really know why Hannah's making me do two equations that look almost the same, because that's really not what I was thinking I was going to be doing at the end of the show tonight. I've only got like a minute left, so Hannah, let's see why you wanted me to do this. Let me move this down. There's got to be a reason.
Yes, there is a
okay.
big reason. You're
okay.
going to like it.
Hannah says there's a reason, so let's see. Now he says do the one, this one in green. So he says, okay, 2x plus 3. Well, I already know how to do this, so let me get going. 1, 2, 3. And then I've got the same slope, rise over run. Okay, 1, 2, and over 1. Right there, I think. Right, Hannah?
Mm-hmm.
Is that about right?
Yeah.
Maybe a little bit more over. Let me just do a little bit, and I'm going to go down 2 and left 1 because I kind of ran out of room. All right, and then I'm going to take my ruler, and this is what you wanted me to do, right?
Surely.
Is to go ahead and graph that the best I can with my big marker.
You're right. In the right track, Danny.
Okay, and then so the green one is y equals 2x plus 3.
Mm-hmm.
So guess what, Hannah? I think I discovered something as we're wrapping up here tonight.
Yes, ma'am.
Those two lines look like railroad tracks. They look
I
like
agree.
Two lines going side by side.
I agree.
So I think you might have tricked me into learning about parallel lines.
I agree, 100%. That's exactly the catch.
Well, that
as
was good.
If they are of the same slope, they end being graphed as parallel lines.
So the fact that they both had a slope of 2 was
that's
the
it.
Key thing to remember.
Exactly. And backward also works, Tammy. If we give you two parallel lines, you suspect that the two slopes ought to be the same, exactly.
Should be the same.
All right.
Well, speaking of being the same, Math Homework Hotline is always the same. It's got good stuff on it.
And it is the same when they replay it on Monday at 6 and Wednesday at 6 as well. So if you haven't watched it tonight for any reason, or you know a friend that would benefit of it greatly, especially this topic that goes across the board all the way to college algebra, all right, tell them we're there Monday at 6, Wednesday at 6, and then Thursday at 6 again. Yes, you're gonna get tired of us, but we know we love you, and we know you love Math Homework Hotline. Looking
Thanks
forward
for
to working with you next time. Good night, everybody.